Hello, my name is Melissa Kelly, and I am a genetic counselor at the Geisinger Genomic Medicine Institute and a member of the ClinGen Education Workgroup. Through this presentation, I will provide a brief introduction into population data. Population data is when a large cohort of people, or a combination of multiple smaller cohorts, is used to understand a variance frequency in the general population. Historically, this type of data was assessed using small cohorts of unaffected controls, but we now have much larger data sets available to evaluate. The variance frequency is referred to as allele frequency, which simply means the number of times that variant or allele was identified divided by the total number of alleles or chromosomes tested. For example, if the variant has been seen as heterozygous in 20 individuals or 20 alleles, out of 10,000 individuals tested, or 20,000 chromosomes, the allele frequency is 0.1%. If the variant is uncommon, this frequency can also be referred to as the minor allele frequency, or MAF. So how is population data helpful? Well, it allows us to identify which variants are common, and therefore generally thought to be benign for traditional Mendelian disease, from those that are rare or even absent from these large data sets. It's important to remember that rarity doesn't automatically mean that a variant is pathogenic or disease-causing, only that it is uncommon enough that it is possible. Population data also allows us to compare the frequency of a variant in affected individuals versus in the unaffected individuals or the general population. When a variant is seen more often in affected individuals, it starts to suggest that the variant is contributing to disease. If the difference in allele frequency between cases and controls is statistically significant, we can say the variant is enriched in that group. Currently, the availability of large population data sets allows us to understand the frequency of a variant with more granularity, and in many instances, has invalidated prior control studies that had only tested 100 or 200 individuals. For example, a published study might have concluded that a variant was pathogenic because it wasn't seen in 100 controls. But our current larger data sets show that the variant is not actually absent from controls, but just seen at a very low frequency. But while population data has provided many benefits to more accurately assessing variant frequencies, there are still important limitations, which we'll go into next, to keep in mind while interpreting the types of this type of data. They include population sample size, the ethnic groups that are included, the phenotypes that are included, and the testing technologies used to generate that data. So why is sample size important? The size of the sample directly reflects, to a degree, the confidence that we can have in the accuracy of a variance frequency. The larger the sample size, the greater the confidence that the calculated frequency is representative of the true frequency. This can also be conceptualized through the calculation of confidence intervals, where the wider the interval, the more uncertainty there is. Therefore, it is important to always consider the allele counts in addition to the frequency percentage. As an example, if we know a variant has an allele frequency or minor allele frequency, MAF, of 1%, that could mean that it has been seen in 1 out of 50 people, or 1 out of 100 alleles, or in 100 out of 5,000 people, or 10,000 alleles. We have much higher confidence in the allele frequency of 1% when it comes from a population of 5,000 people or 10,000 alleles, as is illustrated by the 95% confidence intervals. What populations were included in our cohort? We know that allele frequencies can differ across different ethnic and regional backgrounds, and that a variant can be rare or absent in one population or ethnic group and common in another with no difference in the incidence of disease. Looking at all of the subpopulations included in the cohort and determining which one has the highest frequency will be the most informative. the total allele frequency could be skewed if the variant is common in a smaller subpopulation and very rare or absent in larger subpopulations. Another important consideration is that most genetic studies to date for both cases and controls have been conducted predominantly in Caucasian populations. So our understanding of variant frequencies in other ethnic groups for both cases and controls is still very limited. So when assessing allele frequencies for a variant found in a non-Caucasian individual, it is important to determine if that individual's ethnic group is represented in the population being compared. If not, the comparison may not be informative. One important exception to keep in mind is that if the variant is seen at a high frequency in a different subpopulation, even though it is not the subpopulation of interest, it still supports that the variant is not causative of disease. What phenotypes are included in the population data cohort that you're looking at? As previously mentioned, historically this data was derived from small control cohorts that could be well phenotyped and considered to be unaffected for a particular disease of interest. But to get the large population data sets that are currently being used, thorough phenotyping is often completely impractical, if not impossible. Therefore, we expect that these cohorts will have some healthy individuals, but also individuals with certain conditions or diseases, depending on how they were ascertained. The key question to keep in mind becomes, how likely are they to have the disease of interest? And that all depends on the characteristics of the disease you're thinking about. If it is a rare syndromic, highly penetrant pediatric condition like Cornelia de Lange, most of the current population data sets available, such as EXACT or NOMAD, are unlikely to have affected individuals in there. Whereas if it's a rare non-syndromic condition with variable expressivity and reduced penetrance, something like autism, then it is likely that the current population databases contain some affected individuals, though they may not be representative of the general population. And if you're looking at more common and complex diseases like breast cancer or cardiovascular disease, it is most certain that affected individuals are included, and in some instances, the population databases may even be enriched for that particular phenotype depending on how the individuals in those studies were ascertained. So while most population databases are considered to be representative of the general population, it is important to keep in mind that the particular disease you are interested in may impact how that reported allele frequency can be interpreted. Lastly, it is important to consider what technology was used to generate the population data and what are its limitations. Every technology has its benefits and its limitations when it comes to identifying variants. Since most large-scale population databases currently available are compiled from next-generation sequencing, or NGS, that is what I will focus on. But if you are using other databases, consider what technologies were used and how that might impact what variants were detected or not detected. The EXACT and NOMAD population databases from the Broad Institute are compiled from multiple different whole exome and whole genome studies. With these types of studies, there are several key things to keep in mind. As we discussed with population size, higher depth of coverage, or the number of reads that cover a certain position, increases the confidence in the data at that position. And it is important to distinguish between when a variant is absent due to poor or no coverage at the position versus a variant that has good coverage at that position and is truly absent. The figure at the right illustrates how coverage may differ across several exons in the MYBPC3 gene, and how some exons have high coverage, like the one that is second from the left, and others have much lower coverage, like the exon that is on the far right. Anything below 20x coverage is generally considered to be low coverage, or in the low coverage range. NGS data can call a variant with varying levels of confidence, some being low quality that may or may not be real, and others with high quality that have a high likelihood of being real. In general, the Exact and Nomad browsers will only show variants of high quality. And as with any technology, some variant types are harder to detect than others. For NGS, insertions and deletions can be challenging depending on the size and location, and in many instances, triplet repeat expansions or very large CNVs cannot be reliably detected or accurately called. By understanding the basics of the technology used and its limitations, it is easier to interpret the significance of a variant frequency, or more importantly, the absence of a particular variant. Now, after talking all about the basics of population data and some considerations to keep in mind, here are some population databases that are publicly available. Exact and Nomad from the Broad Institute are currently the most widely used for smaller nucleotide variation, but there are several others listed here that are still available. When you're looking at these different population databases, it is important to keep in mind that Exact and Nomad include samples from multiple sources, including 1,000 genomes and the Exome Sequencing Project. To learn more about using the Exact and Nomad databases in particular, please see the included link to a webinar by Daniel MacArthur from the Broad Institute. When considering all of the different resources that are out there, two of these that are listed are particularly unique. The Discover EHR cohort represents individuals who receive medical care from a particular health system, so it is not intended to represent only healthy individuals. And the Database of Genomic Variants, or DGV, contains copy number variant data from control data sets, which can be useful for assessing microarray results or considering the potential impact of a variant in a gene of uncertain significance. If you are interested in using any of these databases, I encourage you to familiarize yourself with them and consider the various questions I have previously outlined. So to review again, population data is genomic variant data from a large cohort of people used to understand a variant's frequency in the general population. It can help differentiate common variants from those that are absent or rare, as well as identify variants enriched in affected individuals. But it is important to remember the following. Larger sample sizes provide higher confidence in allele frequency estimates. Not all ethnic groups are well represented in current genetic studies or in population databases. Consider the phenotype of interest and the likelihood that current population databases could include affected individuals. And for NGS population databases, higher coverage and high quality variant calls increases the confidence in the data, while absence of a variant is only meaningful with good coverage. I hope this has been a useful introduction to using population data. Please visit www.clinicalgenome.org for additional educational resources and to learn more about ClinGen initiatives. Our funding sources are listed at the bottom of this slide. Please feel free to contact ClinGen by email at clingen@clinicalgenome.org with any questions or feedback. Thank you for your time.